Alrighty. Sorry about that, guys. I had to stop the show because I actually had a possum that somehow got caught in my walls and was trying to escape. And if you listen to the last episode very closely, right towards the end, you can hear the possum escaping. It's a very bizarre experience. But anyway, last we were here, we had our little guys and they were going to Hooverville. They're trying to find a place to stay and maybe try to get out of town. I'm going to see how life works out for them right there. So someone said, "Brother, why don't you feed these boys? That one looks like he ain't eaten 2 or 3 months." Shucks, he didn't have to point or nothing. Everyone knew who he meant. But I didn't care. The food that was bubbling up in those 3 big pots even sounded delicious. The mouth organ man said, "You're welcome to join us, but we all pitch in here. So unless either one of you is carrying one of them smoked West Virginia hams in them bags, it looks like you'll be pulling KP tonight." I said, "Pulling what, sir?" He said, "KP, kitchen police. You do the cleanup after everyone's had their fill. There's a couple of other young folks who will show you what to do." Me and Bugs both said, "Yes, sir." This seemed like a real good trade. A woman handed me and Bugs each a flat, square, empty tin can. "That, my lords, is your china. Please be careful not to chip it." My china had the word Jumbo A&P Sardines stamped into the bottom of it. She handed us 2 beat-up old spoons and said, "Don't be shy. You two just about missed supper. You best hurry up." She took us over to one of the big pots and filled up our tin plates. "You're lucky," she said. "It's muskrat stew. Ew. And there's plenty left over tonight. Eat as much as you can." The stew was made out of dandelion greens and a couple of potatoes and some small wild carrots and some crawdads and a couple of chunks of meat. It tasted great. We both even got seconds. When we were done, the woman told us, "You boys leave your bags here. It's time to do the dishes now." "Uh-oh. Ma'am, I like to keep my suitcase with me wherever I go. I promise you, your suitcase will be safe here." I remembered the Amoses had promised the same thing. I said, "You'll watch it yourself, ma'am? You'll make sure no one looks inside of it?" She said, "Son, we don't have no thieving in here. We all look out for each other." I said, "Thank you, ma'am," and put my suitcase down near the woman's feet. Me, Bugs, a little white boy, and a little girl loaded a whole mess of dirty cans and spoons and a couple of real plates and forks into a big wooden box and lugged them down to Thread Creek. The little girl had been in Hooverville the longest, so she got to tell the rest of us what to do. She said, "I don't suppose neither one of you new boys knows how to do the dishes right away, do you?" Me and Bugs had done tons of dishes in the home, so I said, "Sure we do. We used to be real good at cleaning up." Bug said, "Dang girl, you act like this is the first cardboard jungle I've been in. I know how you do dishes out here." She said, "Okay then, we'll split them up. You and you," she pointed at Bugs and the other kid, "can do half, and me and this boy can do the others. What's your name?" I said, "Bud, not Buddy." She said, "I'm Deza Malone." Deza handed Bugs and the other little boys some rags and some soap powder, and they started splashing the dishes in the water. Me and the girl walked a little farther up the creek and started unloading the rest of the dishes. "You dry, I'll wash," she said. She handed me a rag, and just as soon as she'd splash one of the tin cans in the water and give it to me, I'd dry it and stick it in the wooden box. She said, "Where you say you was from?" "Flint, right here." "So you and your friend come down here to get on that train tomorrow?" "Where's it going?" "Chicago," she said. "Is that west from here?" "Uh-huh." "Then yep, that's where we're heading," I said. "Where are you from?" "Lancaster, Pennsylvania." "You going to take that train too?" She said, "Uh-huh, my daddy is. Folks say there's work out west, so he's going to try again." "So you're gonna wait here for him?" "Uh-huh." She was real fast at washing the dishes, but I noticed she got kind of slow and was touching my hand a lot when it came to giving them to me. She said, "Where's your mama and daddy?" "My mother died 4 years ago." "Sorry to hear that." "It's okay, she didn't suffer or nothing." "So where's your daddy?" "I think he lives in Grand Rapids. I never met him." "Sorry to hear that." Shucks, she held right onto my hand when she said that. I squirmed my hand loose and said, "That's okay too." Deza said, "No, it's not. And you should quit pretending that it is." "Who said I'm pretending anything?" "I know you are. My daddy says families are the most important thing there is. That's why me and my mama are going to wait together for him to come back or write for us to come to him." I said, "My mother said the same thing. The families should be there for each other all the time. She always used to tell me that no matter where I went or what I did, that she'd be there for me, even if she wasn't somewhere that I could see her. She told me..." Shucks, there's some folks who will have you running your mouth before you know what you're doing. I quit talking and acted like I was having a real hard time drying the tin can she just handed me. "What'd she tell you, bud?" I looked at Dizzy Malone, and I figured I'd never see her again in my life, so I kept shooting off my mouth. She would tell me every night before I went to bed that no matter what happened, I could sleep knowing that there had never been a little boy anywhere, anytime, who was loved more than she loved me. She told me that as long as I remembered that, I'd be okay. And you knew it was the truth. Just as much as I know my name's Bud, not Buddy. She said, "Don't you have no other kin here in Flint?" "No." "I guess I can't blame you for wanting to ride the rails. My mama says these poor kids on the road all alone are like dust in the wind. But I guess you're different, aren't you, Bud? I guess you sort of carry your family around inside of you, huh?" "I guess I do, inside my suitcase too." She said, "So you've been staying in an orphanage since your mama died? What makes you say that?" "Well, you're kind of skinny, but I can tell by the way you talk and the way you act that you haven't been out on the road for very long. You still look young." I said, "Shucks, I'm not all that young. I'm going to be 11 on November 14th, and I'm not skinny. I'm wiry. Some folks think I'm a hero." "So, Mr. Hero, we're the same age. But you have been staying in an orphanage." "I've been staying in a home. My daddy says being on the road ain't fit for a dog, much less a kid. How come you don't just go back to the orphanage?" She started up touching my hand too much again. Deza Malone seemed like she was all right, so I came clean with her. "Don't tell no one, but I lit out from the foster home, so I'm out on the lam. And I wouldn't go back to the home, even if I could. It's getting so's this, too many kids in there." "So? That's better than being cold and hungry all the time and dodging the railroad police." "What do you mean?" "You don't think they just let people jump on the trains, do you?" "Well, I guess I hadn't thought about it." "See, I knew you were too nice to have been out on the road. You're gonna have a bad surprise tomorrow morning." "That won't bother me too much." She said, "Oh yeah, I forgot. You're a hero to some folks." When Deza smiled, a little dimple jumped up in her brown cheek. I didn't answer. I just kept drawing tin cans. We got to the last 4 or 5 tin can plates, and Deza said, "You ever kiss a girl at the orphanage?" Are you kidding?" "No." "Why, are you afraid of girls?" "You must be kidding." She said, "Okay," and closed her eyes and mushed her lips up and leaned close to me. Dang, if I didn't kiss her, she'd think I was scared of girls. If I did kiss her, she might blab or bugs might see me and tell strangers about what happened. I looked down the creek to where Bugs and the other boy were still splashing in the water. It was dark enough that I didn't think they could see us too good. I scooched my lips up and mashed my face on Deza Malone's. We stuck like that for a hot second, but it felt like a long time. When I opened my eyes and pulled back, Deza kept hers closed and smiled. She looked down and stuck her hand in mine again, and this time I let her keep it there. She looked out at the creek and the woods on the other side and said, "Isn't this romantic?" I looked out to see what she was talking about. The only thing I could see was the moon like a big egg yolk all the way up in the sky. You could hear the water and the sound of the mouth organ man playing a sad song back in Hooverville. I sneaked another peek at Deza's dimple. She said, "You hear that? That's Shenandoah he's playing. Isn't it pretty?" "I guess so. Do you know the words?" "Uh-huh. Listen. It's been 7 long years since last I've seen her. Wehe, you rolling river. Been 7 long years since last I've seen her. Wehe, I'm bound away across the wide Missouri." I said, "Yep, that's a sad song." I didn't think it was pretty at all. She squeezed my hand and said, "Isn't it? It's about an Indian man and woman who can't see each other for 7 years. But in all that time, they still stay in love. No matter what happens. It reminds me of my mother and father." "Your dad's been gone for 7 years before?" She looked out over the creek like the big eggy moon had her hypnotized. I pulled my hand from hers and she said, "Well, that's just about it for the dishes." She smiled again. "Bud, I'll never forget this night." I didn't tell her, but I probably wouldn't forget it either. I'd practiced on the back of my hand before, but this was the first time I'd ever busted slob with a real live girl. We loaded all the dishes in the box and walked down to Bugs and the other kid. We put their dishes on top of ours and headed back. Bugs said, "How come you're looking so strange, Bud? You look like you've been chunked on the head with a rock." Deza Malone laughed, and for a second, I thought she was going to rat me out. I said, "I don't know, I guess that song is making me kind of sad." Bugs said, "Yeah, it is kind of sad." Right before we got into the cardboard jungle, we passed the white people with the coffin boy at their own little fire. I said to Deza, "How come they're off alone? They aren't allowed to sit around the big fire because that baby's making so much noise?" Deza said, "Uh-uh, they've been invited, but my daddy said you gotta feel sorry for them. All they're eating is dandelion green soup. They're broke, their clothes are falling off of them, their baby's sick, but when someone took them some food and blankets, the man said, 'Thank you very much, but we're white people, we ain't in need of a handout.'" When we got back to the main fire of Hooverville, we put the dishes in another box. Deza made us turn them all upside down, so as if the rain got into them, they wouldn't rust. I went to the woman with my suitcase. It was in the same spot I'd left it, and the knots and the twine were the kind I tie. I said, "Thank you very much, ma'am." She said, "I told you not to worry." I went back to the big fire to sit with Bugs. The mouth organ man said, "I suppose you boys are going out on that train tomorrow." I said, "The one for Chicago, sir?" He said, "That's the one." I said, "Yes, we are, sir." He said, "Well, you'd best get as much sleep as you can. It's supposed to be pulling out at 5:15, but you never know with these freights." We got in one of the shacks with some other boys. Bugs was snoring in 2 seconds, but I couldn't sleep. I opened my jackknife and put it under my pillow. I was thinking, Dessa's mom was right. Someone who doesn't know who their family is like dust blowing around in a storm. They don't really belong any one place. I started wondering if going to California was the right thing to do. I might not know who my family was, but I knew they were out there somewhere, and it seemed to make a whole lot more sense to think that they were somewhere around Flint instead of out west. I opened my suitcase to get my blanket. Even though I trusted the woman who guarded it for me, I checked to make sure everything was okay. I picked up the tobacco pouch that had my rocks in it and pulled the string open. I shook the 5 smooth rocks out and looked at them. They'd been in the drawer after the ambulance took Mama away, and I'd had them ever since. Someone had took a pen or something and had writ on all 5 of them, but it was written a code, so I couldn't understand what they meant. One of them said, "Kentland, Illinois, 51011. And another said, "Lugutti, Indiana, or IN, 51611. Then there was Sturgis, M, 83012, and Gary, N, 61312. And the last one said, "Flint, M, 81111. I put them back in their pouch and pulled the string tight. Then I pulled out the envelope that had the picture of the saggy pony at the misbegotten moon park. It was fine. Next, I counted the flyers again. All five were there. I slid all of them back except for the blue one. I held it up so it could catch some of the light from the big fire. I kept looking at the picture and wondering why this one bothered Mama so much. The more I thought about it, the more I knew this man just had to be my father. Why else would Mama keep these? I used a little trick to help me fall off to sleep. I pulled my blanket right up over my head and breathed in the smell real deep. And after doing this three times, the smells of the shack in Hooverville were gone, and only the smell of the blanket was in my nose. And that smell always reminded me of Mama and how she used to read to me to sleep every night. I took two more breaths and pretended I was hearing Mama reading to me about the billy goat's gruff or the fox in the grave to the dog that saw his reflection in the water or some other story she'd checked out of the library. I could hear Mama's voice getting farther and farther away as I imagined I was in the story until finally her voice and the story all mixed into one. I'd learned that it was best to be asleep before Mama finished the story, because if she got down and I was still awake, she'd always tell me what the story was about. I never told Mama, but that always ruined the fun of the story. Shucks, here I was thinking I was just hearing something funny about a fox or a dog, and Mama spoiled it by telling me there were really lessons about not being greedy or wishing for things you couldn't have. I took two more breaths and started thinking about the little hen that baked the bread. I heard, "Not I," said the pig. "Not I," said the goat. "Not I," said the big bad wolf. Then whoop, zoop, zoop, I was asleep. I started dreaming about the man with the giant fiddle. He was walking away, and I kept calling him, but he couldn't look back. And then the dream got a lot better. I turned away from where Herman E. Calloway was, and there stood Daisy Malone. I told her, "I really like your dimple." She laughed and said, "See you in 7 years." A man screamed, "Get up! You're trying to sneak it out early!" I jumped straight up and banged my head on the top of the shack. I ran outside. It was still dark, and the fire was just a pile of glowing sticks. The man was screaming at the top of his lungs, "Get up! They've fired the engine and are fixing to take off!" Bugs and the other boys came and stood next to me. Bugs said, "Is it a raid?" Someone said, "No, they're trying to sneak out before we get up." People started running all over Hooverville. Bugs said, "Come on, bud, get your stuff. We gotta get on that train." I folded my blanket up and put it in my suitcase and tied the twine back. I put my jackknife in my pocket and Bugs and I ran outside. I hadn't got six giant steps away when a boy stuck his head out the door and yelled, "Hey, Slim, is this your paper?" I looked back. My blue flyer. I forgot to put it back in the suitcase. Bugs said, "Hurry, I'll wait." "I'll catch you, go ahead." I ran back and took my flyer from the boy. "Thanks a lot." I ran back out into the crowd that was tearing through the woods. There were a million men and boys running in the same direction. I didn't want to fold up the flyer, so I was running. I slid it between the twine and the suitcase and put it back inside once I got on the train. No one was talking. All you could hear were the sounds of a million feet smacking on the trail and the sound of a million people trying to catch their breaths. Finally, a hiss sound started getting louder and louder, and I knew we weren't too far away. We broke out of the woods, and there in the dark sat the train. The locomotive was hissing and spitting cold black smoke into the sky. Every once in a while, a big shower of sparks would glow up from the inside the dark cloud, making it look like a gigantic black genie was trying to raise up out of the smokestack. The train went as far back as you could see. There must have been 1,000 boxcars, but everyone had stopped and was just standing there watching. No one was trying to get on. I pushed my way to the front to see if I could find Bugs, and I saw why everyone had stopped. There were 4 cop cars and 8 cops standing between the crowd and the train. The cops all had billy clubs and were spread out to protect the train. The crowd kept getting bigger and bigger. One of the cops yelled, You men know you can't get on this train. Just go on back to Shantytown and there won't be no trouble. The white man said, this is the only train going west for the next month. You know we got families to feed and we've got to be on it. You go get back in your cars and you'll be all right. There'll be no trouble. The cop said, I'm warning you, the Flint police are on the way. This here is private property and they have orders to shoot anyone who tries to get on this train. A man next to me said, I'd rather be shot than sit around and watch my kids go hungry. The cop said, this is America, boys. You sound like a bunch of commies. You know I can't let you on this train. I got kids to feed too, and I'd lose my job. Someone yelled, well, welcome to the club, brother. It seemed like we stood looking at the cops and then looking at us for a whole hour. Our side was getting bigger and bigger, and the other cops started looking nervous. The one who was doing all the talking saw them fidgeting and said, hold steady, men. One of the cops said, Jake, there's 400 men out there and more coming. I don't like these odds. Mr. Pinkerton ain't paying me enough to do this. He threw his cop hat and his billy club on the ground. Everybody froze when the train whistle blew one long time and the engine started saying, shoo, 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 shoo. The big steel wheels creaked a couple of times, then started moving. Four of the other cops threw their hats and billy clubs down too. The boss cop said, you lily-livered rats. And it was like someone said, on your mark, get set, go. The engine was saying, shh, shh, shh. And a million boys and men broke for the train. I got pushed from behind and fell on top of my suitcase. Someone reached down and pulled me up. I squeezed my bag to my stomach and ran. The train was going faster and faster. People were jumping on and reaching back to help others. I finally got to the tracks and was running as hard as I could. I looked up into the boxcar and saw Bugs. He screamed, Bud, throw your bag, throw me your bag. I used both hands to throw my suitcase at the train. Bugs caught it, and when he set it behind him, the blue flyer blew out of the twine and fluttered outside the door. But it was like a miracle. The flyer flipped over three times and landed right in my hand. I slowed down and put it in my pocket. Bugs reached one arm out and screamed, Bud, don't stop, run! I started running again, but it felt like my legs were gone. The car with Bugs in it was getting farther and farther away. Finally, I stopped. Bugs was leaning out the door and stopped reaching back for me. He waved and disappeared into the boxcar. A second later, my suitcase came flying out the door. I walked over to where it landed and picked it up. Man, this is one tough suitcase. You couldn't even tell what it had been through. It still looked exactly the same. I sat on the side of the tracks and tried to catch my breath. The train and my new pretend brother got farther and farther away, chugging to Chicago. Man, I'd found some family and he was gone before we could really get to know each other. There were six or seven other people who didn't make the train, so we all walked back toward Hooverville. They must have lit the big fire again. The sky in that direction was glowing orange. The cop that first threw down his billy club walked over to us and said, he wasn't lying about the Flint police coming, but they're coming to bust up the shanty town. You all should get out of here. When we got close to Hooverville, we heard four gunshots. We all spread into the woods and sneaked up to see what had happened. I peeked from behind a tree and could see a bunch of cops standing around with pistols out. All the men and boys and women that were left in Hooverville were bunched up on one side and the cops were on the other. The fire had been lit and was burning bigger than ever. But now it was burning because the cops were tearing all of the shacks down and were throwing the wood and cardboard and hunks of cloth into the middle of it. One of the cops dragged the big clothes washing pot over to the side and stuck his pistol down in it and shot four more times. Instead of shooting people, they were shooting holes into all of the pots and pans. A man was yelling, "You yellow-bellied lowlifes! You waited till you knew most of the men was gone, you cowards." The cops wouldn't talk or nothing. They just kept piling Flint's Hooverville into the fire. I tried to see if I could spot Des and Malone, but there were too many people. It seemed like the only good thing that came out of going to Hooverville was that I finally kissed a girl. Maybe someone was trying to tell me something. What with me missing the train and the blue flyer floating back to me, maybe Des and Malone was right. Maybe I should stay here in Flint. I walked back farther into the woods and sat down. I pulled the blue flyer out of my pocket and opened my suitcase back up. I smoothed the flyer out and took another good look at it. Maybe it came floating right back to me because this Herman E. Calloway really was my father. Wait a minute. I sat up. The names Caldwell and Calloway are a lot alike. Both of them have 8 letters, and there aren't too many names that have a C, a A, a L, and a W all together like that. I remembered what I read in that little big book, Gangbusters. It said a good criminal chooses an alias that's kind of close to their own name. Except I couldn't figure out who was a criminal here and why anybody needed an alias. I wanted to stay and look for Deza and her mother, but it was too hard to hear all the people crying and arguing. Besides, I was still on the lam. I started walking. If I hurried, I could get breakfast at the mission.